Welcome to the Opie and Jimmy podcast. Looking back at the best segments and interviews from the Opie and Jimmy show. Listen weekday mornings on Sirius XM's Opie radio channel.
Sharon Osbourne. Oh, look at the hugs going on here. Nice.
Hello.
Ozzy Osbourne.
All right, my darling.
Welcome, guys.
Welcome.
It's been a while, Sharon. We haven't seen you in a bit.
Long time.
Long time. How was the traffic? Do you guys get stuck in that traffic?
Yeah.
Everyone's checking out that dumb Christmas tree. We were just talking about it. Hi, Oz.
Yeah, did you guys... Have you guys looked at the tree since you've been in the city?
No, it'd be my first time today because it's the first time that I've actually been this far uptown.
Okay.
Oh, you usually don't come up this way?
No.
Where do you guys stay in the city usually?
In Tribeca.
Nice. It's nice and quiet down there.
It is.
Yeah, it really is. It's a fucking hell of a ride to up here at the time of morning you guys are coming up. It's terrible. You couldn't have picked a farther location.
Tell me Ozzy about it. That's what Ozzy's saying. And every time we stay there, he's like, why are we staying here?
Is Ozzy a tree guy that he goes, Sharon, let's go see the tree? Like it's romantic for him or something?
Is it for you?
What?
The tree.
I've seen a tree before. What the fuck do I want to see that again?
All right. Okay. Then you're on.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. That's a guy. Yeah. You saw it once. Yeah. Same one every year.
And it's the same thing. You don't need to see it.
Well, there's too much pressure to feel something when you see it because it's such a hyped thing that you're supposed to have this great family moment and then you see it and it's just not an eventful thing.
No.
I don't mind the colors.
They're nice. They're nice, but it's not a destination. It's something you drive by and you're like, oh, that's kind of nice and well lit. And then you keep going.
If we had our granddaughter with us, it would be great. But Ozzy and I, as you say, it's just another tree.
Are you guys fawning grandparents?
Yeah.
Are you?
Oh, yeah, the worst. Because she can do anything. We'll just let her do it. And Jack told us yesterday that she's the terrible twos. And so he was exhausted yesterday when I checked in with him. And I'm like, what's up? And he goes... She's starting to have the tantrum, so she's been screaming and throwing
Kelly
herself on the floor.
Again.
It is Kelly all over again. And he was just exhausted, and I'm like, get used to it.
Right, yeah.
I remember when Kelly was little, about that age, and then we had a black dog, and the dog's running across the road, and he's shaking his ass. I'd say she took a drumstick up the dog's ass.
Really?
She did. She put a drumstick in
his butt. What's happening to the dog? And she stuck a drumstick.
That's very coordinated for a young person to be able to fucking pull that off.
She was very coordinated.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, you got to have really good hand-eye coordination to get a dog to hold still and shove something in its ass. That's great. I never did. I just can't do it. You know, I can't commit to a person long enough, and I can't. The idea of having kids to me is just, it's just a scary proposition.
It is scary.
The first time, when you first had kids, were you, like, ready, or did it just kind of happen?
I was 21 when I first had kids.
Wow.
Yeah, Ozzy had kids way before me.
Right.
He had 10 years of them before me.
I just get my wife's
figure
back.
Wow. And literally, I was saying this yesterday to a girlfriend. We had the baby. They send you home with a baby on your knee. I knew nothing about babies. And I was like, what do you do? I had no idea.
And you basically brought the baby on tour, right? Because this was like Blizzard of Oz days, right?
I did like 2 years on the road.
Yeah,
we had a crib at the back of the bus. And she was great.
It was the most bizarre shots back then, too. I remember all the photos, the magazines would have pictures of you two and you holding the Diary of a Mad Housewife where you're ironing the baby.
That's
all these.
Yeah, it's a good old line. When the kids were little, I'd have a bath and they would get in with me and we had a doll in the bath. And somebody said, Ozzy's trying to drown his son. And the doll's legs were sticking out the water.
Yeah, but the baby comes out. They give you about an hour. They show you how to change a diaper, and then they hand you this thing and go, you're ready. I'm like, ready? Are you kidding me?
It's
crazy.
It is. I can remember leaving hospital with Amy.
Right.
And I'm like, what do I do?
Yeah. Where do we begin?
What do I do? It's like, it's the most frightening thing.
It's terrifying.
And the thing is, if you don't have friends that have children of the same age, and we... we didn't. I didn't know anyone that had kids, and it was like, oh, help.
Yeah.
To be, just get through it, I guess.
Yeah.
But I'd be afraid that something would happen or I would fuck up and, you know, that you commit that big mistake. That well, I don't trust myself.
But then the second kid, you just throw him in the back seat and take off. Exactly. You're ready to go.
The first one, you're boiling everything. Right. Everything's boiled. Yep. Everything is like ultra clean. And then the second one.
Not even close. I just wipe it on my shirt here. Exactly. Put it back in the mouth.
Oh, do the wet finger.
Yeah, exactly. All that.
I remember going to when Ozzy would do the record store appearances, you being there with the baby. It must have been Amy at the time.
Yeah.
Like an infant, maybe 6 months old, that, yeah, you know, these crazy record stores with thousands of people there. And you stand there with Ozzy with the little baby.
And now you know why Amy doesn't like
right,
the spotlight.
She's like, paid her dues.
Yeah, I guess it's...
She probably traveled more miles than most people.
Just on the tours?
Oh, yeah.
She lived on the road for 2 or 3 years.
Yeah, and she said she just kind of wants her privacy and to live her life without being hassled. And
yeah, exactly. I mean, she literally, she'd gone around the world twice by the time she was three.
Yeah.
I was reading something about you, Sharon, which I never knew before, and you talked about on the on your show where you had like an incident that I've had many of those emo incidents in my life where, you know, I used to cut myself and be really...
Oh, yeah.
And you talked about that. What kind of motivated you to do that?
Just frustrated.
Ozzy pointed at himself.
I'm like, see what you're doing to me. I can't take this anymore. And like, you know, you'd get the knife off the trolley that had room service, and it's like, I can't take this anymore. And I bang my head against the wall.
Were you guys fighting?
No, I was just drunk.
We used to fight a lot because... It was just the way our relationship was very volatile.
Fiery,
it was
very volatile.
Fiery. So we would as much love each other as fight. And it was
so I wouldn't go to sleep. I'd be drinking and doing all of the substances all night long. And she'd go, well, you got to fucking sleep. I can't tell you and get the nose. I can't take this anymore.
Would you panic when she would do that to herself?
I'd be at the door getting another drink.
Ozzy rules.
I remember once we were in a hotel in London and I'd been awake all night. I couldn't stop. My head was spinning on my shoulders. And I asked the hotel to get me a doctor to give me a shot or whatever. And the doctor comes in and I'm going, what? He thinks I'm fucking insane. He goes, I'm going, can you give me something to make me sleep? And she goes, who's this fucking asshole with, you know? She went ballistic at me in front of this doctor. And the doctor went, oh, I'm leaving now. It's like 7 o'clock in the morning.
Would that be the start of most of the fights? Would it be like that you were up doing what you shouldn't have been doing?
It didn't help matters. But
yeah, no, literally, he would not sleep at all and had to talk. You know what it's like. You've got full of cocaine, full of booze, and you need to talk to someone. And I'm like dying. I'm so tired. And I would find him downstairs, and he would be talking to the night porters in the hotel. He would find some guy up in the hotel, and he would be sat there talking to the porter.
And that guy would be like, wow, I get to talk to Ozzy for 4 hours.
Yeah.
Right. How cool
he's
is this?
He's real friendly.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you see him the next morning, he says hello, and you're
Germany
like...
When I met the record company, I kissed him, took my clothes off.
What? You can't casually say that.
In a restaurant.
In a restaurant.
And got up on the table in the restaurant, totally naked, and then got the guy's drink and tipped his balls in the drink and then gave it back to him.
Did he drink it? I hope he drank it.
No, he was so disgusted with us.
We never got a record sale.
No, then he did the goose step on the table. He was doing...
Obviously not a Black Sabbath fan. Why would you get mad at that?
Yeah.
The hell's wrong with this guy?
But the thing is, once you're nude on top of the table and you pick, how does he let you pick up his drink? I mean, that can't be a good thing.
He was in shock. The guy was in shock.
Who was this guy? Just a stranger?
No, he was the head of Sony Germany. And he was just like absolutely appalled at the behavior. It was like we were doing a World War II tour. We went from Germany to Paris. In Paris, he was like saying to the head of the record company, hit me. Just fucking hit me. And it was going on and on and on through this meeting. That's all he would say. Hit me.
I'm happy now.
Yeah, the guy, of course, wouldn't hit him. So I fucking punched him and go, can we now stop.
Would you be embarrassed when this stuff was happening? Would you like just?
No, I would just be. I can't take any more. I'm tired of this shit.
So he never embarrassed you, all his antics, like out to dinner, like peeing in the jar and all that stuff. That didn't bother you?
No.
That's amazing. that would bother any other woman to ruin dinner and all that stuff.
We're on the plane going back to England. She's going, Germany, contract down. Paris. We never saw fuck all for the longest.
Yeah, because the record companies would be all amped up. They'd meet him, and then they would cut all the you know, advertising and all the promotion. He's crazy.
Would you just get nervous, like when you're doing those meetings, and just drink more?
No, I'm just fucking drunk permanently. You know what it's like.
Yeah, and just acting up.
Just being me.
How many days can you go without sleeping where you finally have to just physically crash?
Three or four days.
I do look at an hour here and there, you know.
Right. He'd have his disco naps.
Disco naps.
What's a disco nap?
You do 20 minutes of nodding and then you wake up again, you know.
Okay, and you got like a little second wind?
Yeah.
All right. How much harder is it now to meet with these people without being drunk?
We stopped, really. We have a couple of really, really good people that we... Because Ozzy's career, he's only ever been on two record labels, which was Warner Brothers with Sabbath and CBS Sony with his solo. So everybody knew him, you know. And when you've been around for, like, as long as him, that's unusual to have only ever been with two companies.
Right,
you know?
Yeah.
Because people jump, they used to jump labels.
Well, nobody else wanted to fucking take me. That was too crazy.
Was it Jet Records, right? Wasn't that Jet Records in England?
That was my father's label, okay. But it was through Sony, CBS.
Okay. And you're the wife and the manager, so at what point do you kind of go like, this has got to stop. We can't function this way.
About a day and a half.
a day and a half after 30
years.
No,
I used to drink with him in the early days.
Oh, fucking hell no. We went in a hotel in Wales one time. I said to Sharon, this has got to stop. Try a joint. She fucking smoked this dope and smacked me over there with a fucking guitar. She said, I don't like that.
And you got hit for it.
Pardon?
No, it made me angry.
Oh, it made you angry.
See, it makes other people mellow and sing songs, and I get angry. So I never did it again.
Oh, you just, that was the difference between the two of you. You have one bad experience, and then you just
kind of... I don't like the way I feel this morning. I'm going to stop. So I thought that'll last about a day or two.
That was with the drink.
On. Yeah.
And then... Fucking never drunk again.
No, I didn't drink for like 15 years with him.
You and
really?
And normal people, you know.
Yeah, it's like you learn from your mistakes.
No, we can't stop. I can't stop. When I start drinking, I got to go to the pass out zone, you know.
Right. Yeah, until you just can't anymore.
I can't do it. Then sleep for an hour and wake up and do it all over again, you know.
How much better is it going on a world tour and not being fucked up all the time through the whole Sabbath tour?
It's you realize the world ain't as bad as you think it is, you know.
Right.
You remember things as well.
Mm. Yeah. Do you ever think of all the cities that you've been in or all the places that you've been in and like that, I could have seen this or I could have seen that. And now that you're going back through, you can kind of experience them.
It's just when you've got to go and start do a rock show and you're hungover like somebody's took your brain out and you got to do it. I never used to go on stage that drunk, you know. I wouldn't take a drink before I go on as a rule. Now and again I would. But it's a better life, you know.
It was the hangovers that killed you.
What's better about it? Yeah. I remember what I did kind of thing. Yeah. I'm more in control of what the next thing's going to come out of my mouth, you know.
Yeah, and it's also like when you're just kind of going on adrenaline, there has to be a crash at one point. You don't want that to be in the middle of a set if you're performing.
It's just it works better for me now. I'm coming up on 2 years, you know. But, you know, this time, I've been trying to stop it for forever, you know.
How amazing, how happy are you that this is happening now? It's got to be just a tremendously more peaceful life, right?
It's peaceful, and it's great to see him being in control and just happier, you know, and you can lead somewhat of a not normal life, but you can have some structure in your life, you know. Like you wake up and you know that you're going to wake up in the same bed and he's going to be there and it's going to be like, you know, you can plan a day.
For you, I kind of get like addicted to weird, chaotic things and crazy. Do you like living with someone who partied so much, do you find yourself kind of is it hard to survive without all that chaos or craziness? Did you get so used to it?
Do you know what it is? I think that when you work in this industry anyway, you're with extreme people. So it's like I call everybody else that doesn't work in this industry civilians.
Right.
And I don't think that we ever get used to working in a civilian world. We just don't, because we are always surrounded by extreme behavior, and it's sexy and exciting. So when you stop and you deal with regular people, it's boring.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess the stuff that's tolerated in entertainment and in music, you're just never going to hear a story about a guy who takes his dick out at a big business meeting.
Yeah.
and dunk his balls.
All these civilians, what Sharon calls them, wants to be a rock and roller for a weekend every now and again. And just let everything go.
Yeah.
You never go, oh, I've got to be up at 7 in the morning to get my transport to work.
Right.
But you know, we live on the road. You know, it's like it's you can't sometimes you can't live with it or without it. You know,
Sharon, how would you get Ozzy like from once the gig was over where he wanted to go crazy to get him on the bus and try to keep him sober or keep him straight for the next show? Was it tactics you would use to just?
Now that's when the fights would start. You know, you think you can, and you think, well, I'm going to be really hard on him tonight, and I'm going to say this, and I'm going to do this, and then it would end up physical. And, it's like, oh, not again, you know.
So just let him have his beers, let him do his thing, and then hopefully...
Yeah.
Hopefully everything will work out. And it did.
Brandy. Yeah. He would go through phases. Like, he still does it with food. Remember we were talking about that?
Yeah, yeah.
About how he goes through these phases. And he would go through the brandy phase, the champagne phase, the gin phase. And literally for months and months, that's all he would drink. And then... next day, it's a total new drink.
Yeah, you just...
All of it had the same result.
Yeah.
A black eye and a headache.
Right.
A spinning room.
A spinning room.
What's a regular day like now for Oz?
Well, she goes to work and I stay at home now.
But what do you do? How do you spend the day, though?
I mean, I like it now. I've got to do a radio interview. I'm so hungover. And I'm just screaming, why did you get me all this work? You know, make some excuse. Because I feel so fucking dreadful from the last bender I've been on for the last month.
Yeah.
But, I used to, the longer the bus journey, the better I liked it, because I could get through four bottles on the journey, you know. So, but now, an hour on the fucking bus, I'm insane, you know. I mean, I hate being on bus. You know, I won't do it.
But what do you do? Do you read? Do you watch TV? You watch documentaries?
Well, I'm dyslexic. I'm fucking blind, so...
It's just the best.
Ozzy loves to draw, so he can spend hours
just drawing.
It's only been what pills I got from... I got like a couple of Vicodins, I'll be there for a week drawing.
Right.
Thinking I'm Salvador fucking Dali again.
Mm. What do you draw?
I don't know.
Just
I just doodle, you know.
Just kind of, it's just like
it's therapeutic.
Yeah,
it gets my head going.
It's like being on the phone when you just catch yourself doing a pattern. It's just something to keep you moving a little
bit.
Exactly. My head tells me all kinds of shit. You know? Maybe if you did that pill with that drink, no, I didn't know. It's screaming all the time, my little disease in my head.
Sure.
It's like being possessed.
Right.
How about the food now? Sharon said the food. What do you go through phases with different foods?
I like Indian food, then I go to Mexican. If I find something that I like, I'll eat that for about 6 or 8 weeks.
Yeah, and then there's
that's all I will have.
But then there's that one day where it's just...
doesn't make sense anymore. Yeah.
He's on the apple pie phase now.
Apple pie. Oh, that's a good phase. I love apple pie. Yeah. Delightful.
We should have had apple pie here today.
Yeah, it would have been great.
We could get one.
I love a nice apple pie.
Oh, I love apple pie. You got to go with the little ice cream, too. A little vanilla ice cream,
does.
Right?
He does.
All right, good.
Beverly Hills. It's right at the back of the Beverly Hills Hotel. We used to go there all the time. It was just great. My wife don't cook. Neither do I. So we go to the Beverly Hills Hotel to eat. But then that Sultan of Brunei, everybody found out he stones women or whatever to death. And so there's this big campaign not to go there now. So I'm going, fucking hell.
No, he's going, the apple pie is 50 feet away and I can't get it.
He can't have it.
That's what he goes through.
We're literally on the opposite corner.
Yeah.
Nobody goes there, all pick it because you still want to get the Sultan of Brunei banished. Mm.
Yeah, because he owns the hotel.
Yeah.
But he's arrogant. He said that he's going to make it his residence if people don't go there.
He bought it without intention.
Yeah, that's what he initially wanted, and the city wouldn't let him. This is like 20 years ago, and they wouldn't let him, so he had to keep it as
but
a hotel.
But when he comes to town, there's like 15 tour buses full of, literally, road is blocked off with buses.
Oh, it's unbelievable. And then you get all the police, the motorcycle cops are there, probably about 15 of them, and all his entourage. There's hundreds of them.
Well, yeah, it's the Sharia law. He pushed, I think, Sharia law in his That's country. Right. And people here are just kind of outraged. And Leno was picketing. And there's so many, like, major celebrities.
It's just weird to think that, you know, if a woman gets caught being unfaithful, you can stone her to death, and if you're gay, you can be
also
stoned to death. It's like,
if a woman's raped,
what are you doing?
Don't blame the woman.
Yeah, they blame the woman.
They blame the woman.
Yeah, yeah. I've heard that over the years. Absolutely.
You commented on Cosby too recently, who you had an altercation with, and the way you handled that what year was that? Like
2002, and he. Somebody asked him in an interview what he thought of the Osbournes, and he was just like horrified, and he said that, you know, it's a terrible example for America, and, you know, we shouldn't be allowed to be on TV. And this is the man who had like 6 months before been sued and was because he had a child out of wedlock and the mother wanted support for the child. And it's like, you people in glass houses should not throw stones. You know, you just have to make sure that your side of the street's clean before you start on anyone else.
Yeah, and you really hammered him. Would you write like an open letter or something?
Yeah, I did. I wrote him a letter and just said, you know, it takes all kinds. You know, it's okay for you to have a child out of wedlock, but if we want to say fuck, we're bad people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's surprising this stuff comes out, but then you're never surprised by, like,
never.
When someone is so opposite the image, it's never that shocking.
No, never. And when somebody, I don't think that people, when they act like they are holier than thou, good, really great people, I get very suspicious about it.
Well, that was like Ozzy wrote that, you know, Jimmy Swagger would always go after Ozzy. And then when all that shit came down, he writes songs about
him. I think we've all got a skeleton in the cupboard, you know, don't ever want to raise. But when you start being, telling people what you think about them, you want to, Sharon just said, make sure your own
street.
But do you have any skeletons, though? I mean, you're so open about everything. I can't.
I've got a few.
Oh, no. Jesus. It's probably really nice things. Like, you know, one time I took a woman to dinner and I didn't drink. It's probably
the complete opposite, right?
I think, Sharon, you have a problem with U2 as well, right? As far as them releasing that album?
You know, I really like them, and I have to say that recently, after I had a go at them openly, we ran into them, and they were so lovely and so courteous to Ozzy, and they wrote him a handwritten note and all signed it, and they were so lovely to him. It's just that I just felt that it was bullshit what they did with their record with Apple, saying that it was a gift to the world of music and they want their music to be heard by millions. And it's not a gift. You got paid for it.
Right.
And it's just an average album. And, you know, like Rolling Stone saying it's the number one album of the year. Bullshit. It's the number one album of the year. But that's the boys' club.
Mm-hmm.
I have nothing against them at all. But the thing is, own it.
Right. And it's making it hard for everybody else with them doing that.
What about new groups that are trying desperately to get heard? It's like I said to Howard Stern the other day, would you come in here for free and do this for nothing?
Of course not.
Of course not. Everybody's entitled to earn a living.
Right.
So, you know, don't give it away for free. That's bullshit. It's bullshit.
Yeah.
And it wasn't technically for free because they got paid.
They got paid a lot.
It was like Apple gave it away for free.
They got like, I think Ozzy's right, about 100 million the band got.
Yeah,
when a big band like that starts doing it, then everybody's I got it for free from you too, so let me just steal it or do whatever and not buy it.
Prince, years ago, in England gave an album away with a Sunday newspaper. You bought this Sunday newspaper. Now, this has to be about 10 years ago. You got a free Prince album. I'm like, what are you doing? Well, everybody's entitled to earn a living. You can't do this. It's not fair.
Not fair to everybody else.
No, for struggling bands, it's fine if you're U2 or Prince. Right. They can afford to do that. But what are all these kids doing that you know.
I love the YouTube backlash, though. Everybody wanted it off their iTunes.
Yeah.
Not everybody, but there were a whole bunch of people, like, they didn't want the free YouTube
album.
You
must listen to my album. Yeah.
The thing was, the first day you could download it, the second day it got delivered to you.
Mm-hmm.
So you were given it whether you wanted it or not, and right. I think that was a bit...
Did you see Bono? Because he got pretty fucked up, supposedly, in a bike accident.
A doctor, a friend of mine, He treated him. He said he broke his elbow, his pelvis.
His
terrible.
His orbital.
But it was was he dressed up as?
No, he was riding a bicycle in the
park.
But
he was dressed up in.
I think.
An aesthetic Jew.
That's what Edge said on an LA radio station.
I
don't believe. I'm not. Yeah.
I'd love to see.
Because there's a lot of people just wondering why there were no pictures after this accident in Central Park. And that's when Edge said, well, he dresses like a Hasidic Jew, and that's why no one knew it was Bono that was in this horrible bike accident.
I mean, he had two terrible things happen within, a couple of weeks. He was traveling on his plane, and the cargo door came off.
Wow.
That's right. And what, a suitcase flew out, didn't it?
Terrifying.
Me
And then the next week to be just riding a bicycle and that horrible accident. I mean, I feel bad. I mean, you don't want to see anybody hurt like that.
You think anyone found that suitcase that went flying out?
I know.
Of the plane?
What was in it? Obviously, his bike helmet.
His album.
You didn't see him, though? Does he look at... Did you see Bono?
I haven't,
supposedly he's... I haven't. They don't want him to move for like 2 months. I mean, he's in bad shape.
Yeah, no photos, nothing.
Nothing.
He must have gone down like a sack of crap.
You know? Right.
Yeah, terrible. I just hope, that he's okay and that there's...
Yeah, so do I.
Oh, the Oz Fiesta's coming up.
Yeah, we're doing that in...
Jim Norton and Jim Florentine
will be
joining Ozzy.
At the end
of May.
That's
going to be unbelievable.
You know, he refuses to go to Mexico. I've talked about Mexico for years, but man, Ozzy says we're going to Mexico. Jim is like, I'm there.
Yeah, it scared me. I was never going to go.
For a long time.
And they're like, do you want to do Oz Fiesta? I'm like, well, where is it? Mexico. I'd be delighted.
But what were you listening to this morning? Tell the guys what you were listening to this morning. What band?
Who the fuck do I know?
Ozzy, what was the band you were listening to and you go, they sing just like me?
Oh, Brown Sabbath. Have you seen them?
No.
Great.
Brown Sabbath?
It's a Mexican band.
They
do covers of Black Sabbath. It's fucking, I got a brass section and everything.
No. Are they going to be there? They're going to be performing.
Oh, they are?
Yes, they're
fucking awesome. It's great.
Do they got videos online?
And the singer sounds just
Can we play one?
Really?
We'll play one to end our show today. Brown Sabbath. Find something, Iraq, if you can.
Wow. It's great, man.
Yeah.
A six-piece brass section, two guitar players, and it's really, really good.
Wow, do you, so when people do covers of you, are you like really judgmental of how they do it, or do you kind of just like the effort?
There's not many people that sound like me. This fucking Mexican guy sounds just like me.
This fucking Mexican guy.
Right. Covering Ozzy Osbourne, doesn't seem to be right somehow.
Sometimes they don't even speak English, the people who cover, like the guy who did...
Journey guy.
Yeah.
The guy in Journey, Arnell.
From the Philippines, wasn't he?
Yes,
from
the Luckiest man alive.
They
plucked him out
of
obscurity. The story goes Neil Sean was just up all night, one night, just checking out guys that imitate Steve Perry and found this guy and gave him a call.
I know.
He was doing karaoke in a bar.
He was just doing karaoke.
People that replace singers that leave and trying to do the same. But I got the same, similar, very close voice to the one I replaced.
Yeah.
Never quite makes it for me.
No,
so.
This guy kind of pulls it off for
he
real.
Does.
He is good.
He's amazing.
Voice.
He's amazing.
Great voice.
So they're saying you guys got to go. This sucks. We're just getting started.
How do people see Oz Fiesta? How do people get tickets to come to that? Just go to OzFiesta.com.
OzFiesta.com, yeah.
And it's like a week-long hangout.
5 days.
On the beach.
On the beach. It's unbelievable setting where they put the stage. It's beautiful. And every day there's going to be different things to do, different bands playing. And the whole family's going to be there. All our friends, Zach, you right. guys. Right,
Black Label's going to be doing
yes.
a regular set, an acoustic set.
Yeah. It would be great if when I was still using cocaine to go down there.
Yeah.
I've been there for like 3 months. Talking to fucking Mexicans.
Well, that's not a bad thing to be talking to Mexicans. It's a nice thing to do in Mexico.
Right. I'm not fucking Mexican guy.
He's got a bad foot. That's what you're looking at.
Okay.
Yeah. Hey, he's
shoe off.
And really fast, the Osbournes are coming back for a quick run to celebrate. How many years has it been?
Oh, we did it 13 years ago.
Is it that long?
It will be, yeah, when this comes out next year, yeah.
And you're doing a quick, what, 8 episodes?
6 or 8, yeah.
Nice.
It's more like a documentary type.
Okay. How did it feel having the cameras back in your house? How did it feel having the cameras back in your house like
that? They're not there yet. They're not coming till like
Oh, you haven't started yet? No. Oh, okay.
Is he on again?
Oh, please.
He said it was off last fucking week.
Are you looking forward to it or you're not?
I'm not crazy about it because it's like when you see like a sequel to a movie that was a big hit and it's like a bit watered down.
That's because we went to see Dumb and Dumber the other day.
No, oh, really?
Did it live not up as to good? The original?
No.
It's a...
We're sad.
Yeah, I heard it's not as good.
Yeah. Is Jack's going to be and Kelly?
Yeah.
Will both be in?
Yeah, and Jack's
Jack with his family and all that, yeah.
Baby, yeah, and his in-laws and...
You guys know. Messed up reality TV. You know that, right? Because then everyone tried to imitate what was really going on with you guys, and then they started writing the storylines and stuff. And
it's unbelievable the way they do it now.
Pathetic. Do you watch the Kardashians at all? I don't get why this show is so huge. They sit around and look at their phones all day.
Do you know what it is? I think that when you've got a family that is so good looking, I think that
that's
the girls
all that matters.
Are so beautiful and exotic
yeah.
that people are intrigued by that. And then they get better looking as the... You know,
the drinks go down.
They're a great. It's all about.
It bothers me because I don't get it because they do huge numbers and they just sit around doing nothing.
Nothing.
I mean nothing.
I think because she did a porno tape too. Kim did that tape and then any girl who like you.
Me and my wife do a porno thing. It'd be fucking X-rated before we started.
But that would be all right for the first season or two. They've been at this
forever.
Forever.
I know, forever. And everybody goes, it'll go away. It'll go away.
It's just getting bigger and bigger.
I mean, people like to look at beautiful women, and that's it.
For your reality show, you should get like a houseboy to move in to kind of help out with the chores.
Oh,
I'll be out in L.A., so I just want to live there for a month.
No, we're going to get a teenage Asian kid and strap him under the bed and keep him there and beat him and stuff like that.
What would you want to do that for?
Make him eat kitty litter.
That sounds like fun for me.
So the Osbourne, that's next year. That's down the road a little bit. Hopefully you guys will come back to promote that.
And you're not going to let them do to what Opie just said, ruin reality TV. You're going to not let them wreck you. Like, you're going to make them do it the same way you did it the first time, which is...
More of a documentary, she said.
Yeah, it's more of a documentary to see where we all are, catch up on all our lives. And it's interesting to see... over periods of time what happens to people because you change, you're not the same, and the nucleus of the family has changed, and it's just, you know, more documentary
right
style.
I felt bad for Kelly being eaten by that shark on that plane, man.
Jesus, how funny was that?
I loved Sharknado. Did you watch Sharknado, Ozzy?
Ozzy doesn't know what it is.
Really?
No.
Fuck that.
It is so ridiculous that it...
Yeah.
Huh?
I've been here 5 minutes. The fucking thing.
Ozzy, headphones are breaking.
Putting them back together. I'm sorry. Ozzy should have better headphones. He doesn't want to touch them.
I mean, that's the way it was. It was psychic, that was.
Yeah.
Yeah, the pad popped off his headphone side. And
right.
It's no, you don't need it. It's fine.
Cheap.
Yeah, it's just shit.
I think we got to get him out of here anyway because we have other. They have other shows to do.
No,
Sharknado.
There's this movie called Sharknado that's really like the hokiest, cheesiest movie, but it's funny because it's so ridiculous.
Shark landing in the streets.
Yeah,
now.
And Kelly was in the last one. She played an air stewardess.
Oh, yeah.
And then the shark came and bit her head off.
Oh, okay.
So it was funny.
On a plane,
it's a
though.
Change.
I mean, how do you get a...
biting someone's head off.
How do you get a shark on a plane? It was crazy. shocking. It was a great scene, though. It was a great scene.
Better than snakes on a plane.
Exactly. All right, I guess we got to get him out of here.
Yeah, we have to wrap up.
There's other people waiting to
talk
to
see you guys again. Mexico.
Yeah, and the whole thing with this hotel, you get the hotel, then there's like $1,000 rebate or something like that, or a credit you could use in the hotel for people.
Yes, exactly.
For all the activities and stuff.
Yeah, everything's included, food, everything. Booze. And the entertainment, and it's just going to be a lot of fun, you know?
Yeah, we're doing a comedy show in a tent one night.
But I feel like we should do some radio shows down there, Jimmy, as well.
I think so.
I think we should
do
some radio down there.
We should go to Juarez and do it for a couple of days. Spend a couple of days just like with the locals in Juarez and
see what it's all about.
Yeah, see if the Osbournes bail us out and we're kidnapped.
Right.
I guess the place is like an hour outside of Cancun, somewhere around there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, the place is amazing.
Riviera Maya.
Everyone talks about it.
Every
that
single
place.
Person that's gone there has amazing. Loved it. So
it's an amazing place.
The beach is great and the hotel, Hard Rock. It's a great.
And the last night, Ozzy does a whole solo. His solo band does a whole set.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. I think it's
and Brown Sabbath too. I can't wait to see that.
Yeah. It's great.
I promise you that you've got to
put them on
YouTube.
It's
so good.
Cool.
Which song do you like by them?
My son just sent me a
I could go easy here.
Video on my phone. And they were doing Fairies Wear Boots. It's great.
Fairies Wear Boots.
You go to Oz OzFiesta.com. Probably should play it in a better way than
this. Maybe we could get on the computer.
Brown Sabbath doing Iron Man, but we should do Fairies Wear Boots to end the show.
Yeah, that's the one. Because
could you go get that
so
real fast, Sam,
like
over there?
It's really cool.
Yeah.
And they're good musicians as well, very good.
The singing is the hardest part, though, because you can find guys that can play the music, but it's obviously the vocals are always the tricky part.
You'll be surprised
very
when
close
you hear.
Yeah.
So well, I do.
Cool. Real quick, is there going to... they said another Black Sabbath record, possibly?
Well, we're in negotiations right now. I think we're going to do one, but it's not been confirmed yet.
So it's still kind of in the talking
phases.
Well,
it's funny, but we leave here tomorrow to go to England to meet with all the Sabbath guys, and we're going to discuss what they want to do and what they don't want to do. So
right.
A little maybe band meeting.
At the end of whatever we do, it's going to be the last thing we do anyway.
Right.
Together.
It'll be the last hurrah.
Is Bill possibly involved, or they don't know yet, or there's no talks about it?
There's no talks about it, but I know I'm talking for Ozzy, but I know that Ozzy wants Bill. They all
yeah.
want Bill.
Yeah, I was reading that it was kind of hard.
Do.
It's
not. Tommy's a great, great drummer, but it's not Bill Ward. They're not saying that Bill Ward's any better than him. But Black Sabbath was the four of us.
Right.
And it's kind of, what I'm proud of is that we weren't a creation of some business mogul in England. We were four guys who lived in the same area. We had to go up being a band and look what happened, you know.
Yeah, and you began kind of in pretty much poverty and went to where you went. And kind of better to end that way, too.
I mean, it would be great if Bill can't play the whole thing, just to come on and do a couple and just be a part of it.
Yes.
But...
Right, maybe do the album and then come out and play a few songs on the tour.
I really would love to get Bill back in here. I would love to end it. We started off, and it's been a rocky road for all four of us, but it'd be great to end it on the same note as we started all them years ago.
And even if Bill, like you said, can't play the whole set, if he came out and did the last few songs, people would be so happy just to see the four of you guys taking the bow together. Everyone understands that you get older, it's harder to drum.
Exactly, and the thing is, it's about being a part of. Nobody expects more than what you can do, you know? And the thing is, we all know that with this music and... a double kit to be a rock drummer, you have to be a fucking athlete. You have to be. Mm. And to do a 2-hour set, you need to be on your game. I don't know any rock drummers that still do it at Bill's age. They can't physically do it. It's not just Bill. Name me guys that can do that, a 2-hour set with a double kit.
Absolutely.
With no stop.
A Charlie Watts and the Rolling Stones just going, it's easy. Yeah, jazz kind of
jazz. Bluesy drummer, tiny little kit.
But even Charlie
tapped
out.
It's more cymbal than drums.
Yeah. I mean, Tommy, my drummer, he's a young guy. He gets up and works out for an hour or two every morning. And I go to him, what do you do on the break? He goes, got up, exercise and play drum. That's all he do.
Wow.
Yeah, he's unbelievable on the drums.
You've got to be an athlete. And it's not, it's the same as saying that a footballer can still play at 65. You can't.
Right.
It's impossible. You know, you can't play on a team at 65. Yes, you can play, you know, with friends in the back garden, but you're not going to be on a... On
you're not
a,
on the pros, you know, anymore.
You've got to be consistent.
On a number one league team.
Right.
It's the rhythm of the band is a drummer. You know?
They're screaming at us that we have to end. Your rep is freaking out because you, you have to go do other press.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
All right.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. We have to end anyway.
Yeah, okay. It's Ozzy and Sharon Osbourne. Go to OzFiesta.com for that huge trip.
It's going to be great, yeah.
It is going to be amazing.
Opie and Jimmy podcast.
Chris Rock.
Chris Hay.
Yeah, wow. Hey.
Just walking in like that. How are you, sir?
Chris Hay. Right now?
What's going on? Yeah. We were going to take a break, right, but now. Fuck it. How are you, buddy?
Hey. I'm all right, man.
I got to tell you, we all saw the movie on at the premiere.
Wednesday.
We got to go to the premiere, actually, and holy fuck, you got a great movie on your hands.
Trying, man.
Trying.
I'm trying to stay in show business, man.
Trying to
understand. I got to stay ahead of Sharon.
That's right.
I have to stay in an oppressively more famous than him. It has to be.
I agree.
It has to make him miserable.
Yeah, it makes me happy. I don't want you coming to me for money. It works for both of us.
This movie was fucking funny, man. And you put the nipples in the movie. Thank you.
Yes, yes.
We were brought up with comedies where you had nipples.
And it's the last sighting of Anthony. There you go.
Yes. Yes.
It's like Anthony's in the movie. Anthony, right. Wherever you are.
He's a little mad that he wasn't invited
Anthony,
to the premiere.
It's
sir.
Like Pete Rose. Just say you did it. Get reinstated. Right. I don't know where you are. Somewhere with fucking Jackie the Joke Man. We'll show them. We'll start our own radio network. Anthony, you're too fucking funny. Did I curse?
You can curse on this.
Okay, yeah. I was just
get reinstated. I like that.
Norton, did you get a raise? Did you get Anthony's money?
No. There's a yes and a no in there. I got a little bump in money, but did I get Anthony's money? Nothing close to Anthony's money.
We got a little bump. Nothing crazy.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah, no.
Norton, man.
No. Yeah, you put us in the movie, Chris Rock. Well,
in the movie.
I'm not really in it.
Yeah, in there.
Just because it's
fuzzy
blurry,
in the background.
But you're still there. We see
I'm fuzzy.
You.
I'm fuzzy.
Wait, is everybody in here in the movie?
Wait, pretty much, Sam.
Except my own brother.
Yeah. I was around. I was
Sam's
around.
In the movie.
Oh, yeah, Sam looking awkward and androgynous.
That's right. In the background.
Looking like Malcolm Gladwell.
Yeah, and I had a problem with the way I was edited because there was one thing where you cut away from me and my lips move. Like, you're talking and I go like...
He's sniveled.
It's awful.
The movie's going to do real well. Well, that's
Let's
what you're so. Gonna remember.
It's hilarious because it was written. You can tell it's written by a comedian. It was like it was just funny shit. The language was harsh. It was great. It was really, really laugh out loud funny.
It's like a set. You shot it like a set. Like his laughs all the way through, big laughs, and then explaining, and big laughs. And then it ends. Fun. It's just like
and you
a
got
set.
Some romance in there. Rosario Dawson is really good.
I
to
did
look
the
at.
Whole movie just to kiss Rosario. That was
good call.
It was a sting operation.
Good call. Good call.
The guy who played her boyfriend, I thought he has the best fucking gig in the whole film.
Oh yeah, what's his name?
I don't know his name, but Anders. He gets to roll around with her. I'm like, that's
from
the guy.
Workaholics. He's from Workaholics on Comedy Central.
Me and Jimmy were walking home after the movie, and that's the final edit, right? No one's going to say you got to cut down a couple of these scenes.
Let's hope not.
That's what I was thinking.
No. It's
white guy naked. That scene's got to be in there. And you naked.
Yeah.
On that wet mattress.
Right.
Very funny.
I don't know what you want us to say because I don't want to give away any of the punchlines
or any of the cameos
or anything, but. I mean, Cedric the Entertainer almost steals your movie.
He
by
does
the way.
Steal the movie. Whoa. It's the funniest Cedric the Entertainer's ever been.
That's that 20 minutes is some of the best stuff I've ever seen in a comedy. Holy fuck! Right?
Yeah, he plays a real fucking creep.
Oh my!
From
God.
The airport to the hotel, every time you see it, it's just hilarity.
Yeah. And then how that scene ends, like you sort of said, is just amazing.
Said the Entertainer, man.
Amazing.
And he's such a clean comedian, too. He's not a dirty
comic. I know, but yeah. I know. You know what? The one advantage to me directing it is I know who these people are really.
Right.
Off stage, so I try to get that part of them on.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
So Sed's got a little bit of that guy in him.
Right.
Yeah. You know, a brother from St. Louis.
And what's sad about that is off stage, that means I go.
And he needed to capture that. Our pal Brian Regan's in there.
Regan's hilarious.
Kills.
Jesus.
Yeah. JB Smoove is fucking great.
Yes. Right.
JB Smoove is good.
He's a really, really funny dude. And he's such a weird funny. Like talking about fucking honey roasted peanuts. He killed talking about honey roasted peanuts. Yeah.
How many comics are in this, Chris?
I don't know. 10, all of them? 20? I don't know.
A couple dozen easy.
Yeah,
probably 20.
Man.
A lot of comedians.
Bruce.
Just to have Bruce and Brian Regan in the same room. Like two totally different comedy universes.
Did you expect it to turn out as well as it has? I mean, there is a buzz in this movie. I read an article that you did for Vulture Magazine, and you were like, this is my small little movie, and then all of a sudden it just exploded on you.
It exploded, I thought I was going to have to pay for it myself. Honestly.
Really?
Yeah. I wrote it, and I was like, okay.
And there was a feeding frenzy. People were like outbidding each other, and... Wow.
We'll see. Friday.
We'll see.
See if anybody wants to see it.
It's legitimately hilarious.
Could be the chocolate rain of movies. just because you got a lot of YouTube hits doesn't mean people want to pay to see you.
Oh, that was so... You're talking about...
Got 30 million hits.
Right.
Will you buy a ticket? Hell no.
It killed in the, like, I've seen comedies not do well even in front of the audience that they're supposed to do well in front of, and this fucking, it crushed. I mean, there was gigantic laughs through the whole thing.
What I learned, Gail King is a dirty girl because she was sitting right behind me and she was laughing at the really edgy stuff. I'm like, way to go, Gail.
Yeah, Gail got some
way
filth
to go,
in it.
Gail. You think?
Yeah, of course. Right. She got some filthy in it.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's an animal.
And
I like her.
The best part was that you actually had Rich Voss in there and you didn't use the take. This is where you go, hey, Voss. He's like, I wanted them to use that take. Like, you know, him and Chris are together. I'm just happy you didn't. You treated them like the anonymous nothing you should have. The guy at the door that you should have.
I got to keep Voss in his place, too.
Absolutely. Just say me. It really looked like I was standing there. Well done, Rich.
And you captured the Comedy Cellar, you know, perfectly for this movie. I don't know what we're supposed to talk about.
Do you think about doing that movie with Julie Delphi help you direct this movie? Like, gave you a vision?
Oh, totally.
Like, how? Like, in what way?
And just because the tone. Like, I've done other movies, but because I wasn't confident in what I was doing, they're just so silly, my other movies.
Right.
And this one, I kind of kept in a dramatic tone. Kind of like what I did with the play, too.
Right.
The play I did is kind of this tone. So there's a lot of jokes in this movie, but the drama works.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That's the key to the movie.
I agree.
You were not confident in what you were doing? That's interesting to hear.
Yeah.
When you were what? When you were doing like...
Head of State or whatever. Yeah, those movies were just... I don't know.
Because movies are still different from stand-up. And you're going
to
do
very collaborative, too. Like, right. I didn't have a studio with this one. I kind of just had to work with Scott Rudin, so I didn't have, like, 12 people giving me notes and telling me about, this doesn't work with this quadrant of people and this quadrant and that quadrant. Like, I had none of that shit in my ear.
So it was kind of made before they got their hands on it, and that's why it works.
Yeah. Paramount is putting the movie out, but they didn't have...
Like, anything to do with it.
No,
right.
Nothing
to right.
do
with
it.
Yeah. They just got it in the end.
Yeah, they got it in the end.
So to speak.
Yeah.
Hopefully not, actually.
No, that's going to make a lot of... It's going to make a lot... Were you nervous about releasing
Opie
it?
Opie Radio. So when they took down the Opie and Anthony stuff, were you here?
He demanded it.
It's like when... my God.
I'm in a very strange situation, Mr. Rock.
Wow. They had to take down and rip it off. And
It was sad to just see that up there. And then we went with the beige wall for a while. And then
we'll
see what happens.
Opie Radio.
Crazy.
Somebody benefits from racism. They say no one wins with racism.
Opie wins.
Making my life even harder.
Some people win.
Opie made the whole thing happen. Ant would come in and Opie go, did you see what these people did?
Just directing them, pushing articles toward them.
Yeah, Ant has a funny line in the movie, man. It's really
very funny.
I laughed out loud when I saw that. I was like, fucking so happy to see him on the big screen. Giant headed him.
See him on the big screen. See him. When's the last time you seen him?
I go to his house and do his podcast, his radio show.
And I wrote him the other day because he's mad that he wasn't at the premiere. And I go, well, none of us were invited to the premiere. We were invited to see the movie because they wanted us to see it before you came in here.
Oh.
I don't think we were officially invited
to
the premiere.
We were supposed to go see it on a Thursday. They said, well, you're going to see a screening. And Chris, you know, it's just the publicist to say, Chris is going to come in and they'd like you to see the movie first.
Yeah.
Understandable. And then, like, the day of, Roland's like, no, it's tonight, and it's the premiere you can go to. So, which I didn't even have a plus one.
You definitely got to see it with a crowd. You want to laugh along with
absolutely.
People.
Absolutely,
it's a different movie with a crowd,
a real audience.
Yeah, with a real audience.
And yeah. I love the fucking language. You didn't soften, you know, because stand up is never funny when it's cutesy, and you left in a fucking really harsh, there's funny
some,
language.
There's some N-bombs in there.
Yeah.
N-bombs.
Absolutely. Oh,
yeah. You know,
gotta do it, man.
Gotta do it.
And Tracy was hilarious. Fucking Leslie was hilarious.
Leslie was a star.
Wow, was she great.
Leslie is great.
Everybody that watches it says, all the directors I let watch it early on were like, who's that woman? That's all they wanted to know.
Made her a bigger star.
You think it's going to Melissa McCarthy her career, huh?
I think she's got a shot. I think Said the Entertainer is
going
to.
Oh, forget
it. I think. I told him he should make his agents make sure he's like, you know, has an Oscar campaign.
Right.
If Melissa McCartney could get an Oscar for shitting in a sink,
right.
She got, right. You know what I mean? Like she got an Oscar nomination for shitting in a sink.
Yeah.
Sand is that good.
Yeah.
In that scene.
I agree.
He is legitimately hilarious.
That should be a spinoff. Imagine a whole movie with that character.
I'm telling you.
Wow.
I'm telling you.
And you guys know those type of guys when you're on the road doing comedy,
isn't that,
right?
Isn't that every promoter that picks you up from the airport?
They're the ones that pick you up from the airport, and they can do whatever you need.
It was an inside look on reality. And
I felt like I knew that guy just from hanging out with you guys. I really did.
Coke, weed,
hookers. Yes,
right.
I'm the motherfucking man in Houston.
And there's that awkward scene where like the tickets aren't selling that well, and like, that's every weekend for me.
Tickets are going a little slow. You know, the hair show in town, but we expecting a big walk up.
Like, and you go to a nightclub to promote it over while the music's playing. It's just shitty. It's like, oh fuck.
You can relate a little bit, Jimmy.
Yeah, it's like those things that you do, and then you just say it into a mic when no one's listening. Yeah. Oh, it's the worst. It captures a real moment of uncomfortability as a stand-up, what you got to go through to promote your fucking gigs.
How much did you have to edit out of that movie? That's what I was thinking, because when you're working with legitimately funny people, there had to be a lot of shit. You're like, man, we just can't use that.
Some of it was just too silly. You know what I mean?
Really?
Like, I had to.
What do you do with that stuff? I
put it at the end. Put some of those bloopers at the end and show it.
DVD
You'll throw it
whatever.
On a DVD or
when
something?
When the credits are rolling.
Yeah.
What about like when the credits rolling, show some of those scenes?
Like Cannonball
Seinfeld,
Run.
We had to do after one of his scenes is after the credits, so.
Yeah.
That was a, yeah.
Safe.
So you are saying
that's right.
That Seinfeld's
in the
movie.
We didn't want to blow the cameo, but he's hilarious.
Seinfeld in the strip club is fucking hilarious.
So funny. Him making it rain.
Yeah. Unbelievable, man.
Quite funny. I've never seen him like that. That's the real Seinfeld, by the way, I'm sure.
That's what I'm thinking.
Fucking animal.
That's what I'm thinking. That's the real guy.
Yeah, you never know with comedians what's going to turn up about them, obviously.
Was that a Bill Cosby thing you just said?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah,
you know. Oh, God. Oh,
what do you think of Cosby?
You know him. You had dinner with him. Meals with him.
Yeah, I know him.
How was the wine?
Wow. It's unbelievable.
It's unbelievable.
It's getting ugly.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it's like nobody wants to believe that we, if it's all true, nobody wants to believe that we cannot judge a guy or whoever, you know, that accurately. Like, but we've all been this wrong about a guy.
Right. Well,
Fat Albert's having a press conference.
Chris is like, leave me alone. Leave me all out right. of this fucking
like,
thing.
Come on, man.
I'm here to talk about top five.
Top five, man.
Is Bill Cosby in the movie?
It's hard if you know a guy, too.
Every comedian except Bill Cosby is in the movie.
Good.
That's the advertisement.
Yes.
I enjoyed your article in Vulture Magazine. You went serious, too. A lot of serious topics.
They ask, you answer.
Right. I mean, you don't like playing colleges anymore? Something that...
I played a college town. It's just sometimes you got to get those guys off the campus.
Right.
For them to behave.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you literally play a a venue 3 miles from the college, and the behavior is so much
completely
different.
Right?
Because it's something we've talked about in here many, many times. Where what's going on with these colleges? What do you think changed them?
Everybody's just so PC now, man. Everybody's
but why?
Just so...
What happened?
Remember that movie PC University with Justin Long?
Yes,
it's coming true. It's already been true.
You know, it's
nothing more
Anthony,
annoying.
You know, Anthony says what he says 15 years ago, and it's like okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Maybe there's a half an apology. Maybe.
Right.
You know, then it's, you know. But now everybody's so scared of everything, man.
Yeah, they're going after you guys, too. So, I never thought they would go after stand-ups. You know. They've been going after radio guys forever.
Right.
And you mentioned you mentioned that Carlin saw that. He said that in an interview that we had done with him in 2007. He said, he's like, I hate to say it, it's the college campuses. It's where all the censorship is coming from. Yeah. They are the worst.
Yeah.
That is sad.
They used to be about free thought and, you know, being different and, they're terrible.
Awful. Police states.
I can't, but you can't say that. That's sexist. You can't say that. That's racist. Oh, that's homophobic. Like, it's like, what?
I think that's why that UVA rape situation where Rolling Stone got so big. Because you can't even second guess anything coming off a college campus now. Right. If they say it happened, and we got to do something about it.
And Rolling Stone's now in trouble.
Big trouble.
Well, they showed lousy judgment. I mean, they put the Boston Bomber on the cover in a glamour shot. Like, they've done a few things in the last couple of years. Like, what the fuck?
Out of control.
You know.
But it's college. There's nothing more annoying than a college kid because you think you know everything before you know anything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well,
it's this culture, like it was in the article. Another thing we talk about is where everyone wins a fucking trophy.
That's the dumbest thing. It's the dumbest
shit. I'm a parent.
Ever.
I don't want that shit. Can I find a league where there's actually winners and losers?
We can lose. Whereas mostly losers, and then like life,
right? Yes. Thank you.
You know, in life, most people lose,
right?
You're sitting between two of them.
I played sport.
No. The winner of racism, racism advancement awards.
Why are we accepting that? Where you don't keep score, everyone gets a trophy. It's the dumbest thing ever.
It's the dumbest.
I grew up with sports, and we'd get our ass kicked, and then on the way home, I had the conversation with my dad, I'd be bummed and shit, but he would talk it out.
That's
with me.
What a lesson to learn.
Thank you.
Losing.
So what? Parents are lazy and they don't want to deal with their kid being shitty or crying or
because
something because they lost?
These kids already think they're number one before they even played.
Yeah.
So they don't want to take that away from those kids. It's like they don't want them to strive for it.
It's mind-boggling. I got my kids in school finally, and the shit they're doing. He's only four. No holidays. They don't celebrate holidays. You can't go to school in your Halloween costume.
One of my daughters does a gymnastics. They have trophies all the way to seventh place.
Right.
Wow. What is seventh place in gymnastics? They break your legs?
It's like, seventh place? All right.
But at least they got first.
At least they got first. Okay. So like, seventh.
Yeah, that's what a kid who never showed up. He's like, thanks, y'all. Thanks.
I would scratch that seven, make it into a one when I got home.
Yeah.
I wouldn't display that.
No. Is it the same size
as
the other trophy?
It's a little smaller, but still. Yeah.
Comes under a magnifying glass and show people when they come over.
Seventh place?
Yeah.
It's too much.
That's where we are now.
Probably 10 competing.
Yeah, yeah. Hmm. Yeah, man. Yeah. That's how bad it is.
People who don't want to do their jobs and just explain shit. That's all it is. You're just not that good at it.
Other countries just got one trophy for their kids. You win or you lose.
Or you die.
Yeah.
I mean, the rest of the world's not playing by these fucking rules. I think it's going to really hurt us eventually, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so. It seems logical.
If kids don't have to work to strive for anything, and everybody in like China, all these kids got to work to get anything.
But I always thought that the parents were becoming pussies, and then when I'm in it now, and you realize you go to the father to your right, like, what the fuck is this shit? And they're like, I don't know, what is this shit? And then you learn that it's a very small minority that is controlling this.
You got to speak up. You got to speak up. There's more people feeling like you, I think, than feeling like everybody got to get a trophy.
That's what I've learned.
Yeah.
I just thought all the parents were like, I don't want my kid hurt. They're all like, no, well, I'm in. Yeah. Win or lose. That's how we were brought
up.
Absolutely.
We want our kids in the Cub Scouts while the guys are hard on showering.
You missed some great radio, Chris.
Yeah, we got a phone call.
Fucking Sharon abandoned his friend.
Oh, yeah, Boy Scout camp at 10 Mile River. This was with Mr. Lee and all of them, but this was like a...
You're naming names now?
Well, this is not a guy who molested us. This is a guy who protected us.
All right, you better make sure you
say
that.
It was the scout leaders at this camp, and everybody knew who was the molester.
Wow.
But they still got to work there every summer.
Yeah, but he was on a canoe with a friend.
And I jumped off the canoe and
left his friend
back.
Get molested on a private island.
Yeah. They were fucking Thelma and Louise, and he jumped out of the car before it went over the fucking over the cliff.
Wow.
I did. Sorry, Freddie.
He knew something wasn't right, so he abandoned ship, but he doesn't take his buddy with him.
I warned him.
Yeah.
I warned him.
And it was a private island where they go and pick fruits or something?
It's right in New Jersey.
I don't know about
Camp
this
Kiowa,
place.
10 Mile River.
All right.
Wow.
Awful place to be molested. A private island.
Oh, What happened over there?
No. Oh, no. Brandon.
Your video of how not to get beat up by police is getting a lot of of views, man, because of everything that's going
on. Yeah, man. I don't know what to, you know. I don't get a royalty for it.
It's a great video.
Is it a YouTube video?
Yeah, they're passing around ever since the Ferguson thing and Eric Gardner.
Okay.
What's your thoughts on that?
I got nothing. I mean, Ferguson it's all about Eric Gardner, mm-hmm. honestly, because so you're not charged with anything?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Anything? Reckless something?
Sherrod was saying at least go to trial facts come out.
Even professional wrestling has barred the chokehold. Okay? So the WWE has higher standards than the New York City Police Department.
You got something on it. You said you had nothing. I think you got a pretty good line right there.
That's true.
Right.
Yeah.
Even, you know. Yeah, Stone Cold Steve Austin knows. I'm disqualified. I can't choke him. I'll be disqualified.
Right.
And you think Hollywood's a white industry?
Well, it is.
Oh, I don't know about that.
NBA is black. What do you want?
I know. Did we sell this movie properly, you think? It's funny as hell. It's got nipples. It's got Seinfeld. It's got Rosario Dawson.
It's got breasts. They're like full nudity in it. And
yeah.
She is so fucking good to look at.
She's just fun.
When she sat here that day when you were filming, we were all just staring. Yeah. And we all felt like we had a shot with her. We're idiots.
That's her thing.
That's her appeal.
That's her appeal. She makes you think you actually have a shot of fucking her.
Yes.
And you have no shot of fucking her.
not a chance.
No. No.
I agree.
You see a boyfriend, he's a fucking surfer or whatever.
Oh, really?
No shot of fucking her.
You sure?
And you're laughing. And
like, oh, you're working it.
She likes my jokes. We're connecting. Oh, she likes Pee Wee's Playhouse too. Cut to, you have no fucking shot.
None.
You call her when the movie's over, numbers change.
She Janet Jackson you. That's how Janet did Tupac.
I was kissing her.
Oh, it was great.
Do you set it up nice?
A lot of takes of that one.
Really?
Nice.
What do you do? Like, you make sure your breath's all right and all that?
Yeah, you know, get some mints.
Get some mints going?
Yeah, you know.
Now, you're directing it. You directed it, too, so it doesn't feel funny. Like, let's do it one more time.
Yeah, let's do it one more time. I said just like that.
Let's do a safety. Let's do a safety. I think I got it, but let's do a safety.
We need some more.
That's all I would have done is write scenes like that in the movie if I had her.
You know what? I had a couple other ones, and she got rid of them. Nope, we don't need that.
Oh, really?
We don't need that kiss. We don't need that.
Oh, you put in a few? A
few extras?
A couple of, you know.
Oh. How humiliating that she took him out.
She's like, nope. Don't need that page.
Oh, no. You never want the girl taking the kisses out. That's embarrassing.
She's like, oh. She was like, nope.
Wow.
I don't really need to be in my panties in this scene. Okay.
Yes, you do. We're walking down the street. It's believable.
She's like, nah. Like, okay.
That's really funny.
Okay, Rosé.
Did you write it with her in mind, or did you kind of write it not sure who you were going to get?
I wrote it with her in mind, but I still wasn't sure I was going to get. I mean, and I had to meet a bunch of actors because she didn't want to do it at first.
Why?
Because she's Rosario Dawson, and she's got options.
Right.
Was there anything she objected to that you changed? Like, no, if you do this, I'll do
she
it.
No. She was just didn't like the character, and, you know, and she's made out with Will Smith on screen, so
right.
She didn't want to go down. Making out with me. It's like, it's a big letdown.
You think so after Will Smith?
Yeah, after Will Smith. You know, she's made out with Will Smith, The Rock.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, she's got.
She was in Alexander, too, with Colin.
Yeah, she's like, she's had some biggies, so, like, she didn't want to make out with me.
Oh, shit.
Like, that was real acting.
Yeah. She used all her Meisner in that one.
We got our redneck pal on the line.
Uh-oh.
And he's a huge Chris Rock fan.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Wanna try it for like a minute?
Sure.
I don't know how much more time we got with Chris, but Chuck, what's up?
Hey man, how y'all doing up there?
Chuck, please don't use the N-word.
Hey man, Chris Rock is one of my favorite comedians, and plus in the movies. That movie he did about when he ran for president with Bernie Mac. What was the name of that?
Head of State.
God damn, that was funny as hell. I know Bernie Mac had to be funny to work with.
Oh, he was amazing.
You got.
Oh, yeah, I love Bernie Mac, man. Love him, man. I like Chris Rock. His stand-up, it keeps you interested from the beginning until he quits and throws his hands up in there. You know, he's just a funny guy.
He's one of my favorites. Really, you're one of my favorite stand-ups of all time, Chris Rock. You got a question for him, Chuck?
Well, I always thought what y'all was talking about, basketball and Carmelo Anthony. Here's the way I see it with the NBA. If you all they do is run a fucking pick and roll all fucking game, and if you've got a guy that gets the pick set for him, and he ain't never going to pass it and shoot it every time, goddamn, what have you got? You know what we call them down south?
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do. Shut up. We don't want to blow our friendship.
You just said not to use that word.
Yes. What?
We call him a gun. He shoots every fucking time. He stands up there and holds his hand up in there. How many fucking offensive rebounds has Carmelo Anthony got?
I don't know.
He sucks.
He does not suck.
He's a great player.
You want to see him working off the boards more.
I don't know. I don't know shit. But
right. He needs the damn. You got to play five players. But I'm definitely going to go see Chris Rock's movie. No doubt about it.
Top five. I'm telling you, we all saw it, and a lot of us are excellent. Sort of in it. It's great. It's a great movie,
because
Chuck.
We're all in the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That girl that was in that Head of State movie. That was his girlfriend. She was good looking as hell, too.
Oh, Tamala. Oh, she's gorgeous.
Tamala, right.
Hell, yeah.
Tamala Jones.
When she smiled, man, she kind of gave me a funny feeling.
I would imagine. All right, Chuck, thank you.
Hey, if I don't talk to y'all have a good Christmas.
Yeah, all right, Chuck. See you later. You're not going to talk to us.
He does Christmas trees in North Carolina.
Wow.
Yeah.
Are you comfortable with your acting now? You said you were insecure at one point.
I mean, you're never comfortable, but I'm more comfortable.
For comics, it's a weird...
Broadway changed the whole game for you as far as acting. You think that?
Yeah, Broadway. Because you got to act on Broadway. There's no faking it.
Right.
You know, a movie, they got takes.
Right.
We can make you seem like an actor, but you can't fake it on Broadway.
Mm. That was with Bobby Cannavale, who's
amazing.
Awesome.
Amazing.
And the play was great.
One of the stars of Black Annie.
Oh,
is
really?
Isn't it?
Yeah, Black Annie.
Are they calling it Black Annie?
Not officially, but...
It's going to be some marching.
That's going to cut down the numbers if you call it Black Annie.
Yeah. Exodus is in Egypt with no black people, and Annie's black.
Oh, yeah, Exodus. Didn't they just get shit for that? Because there's a bunch of Christian Bale?
Yeah. I'm not saying they look like, you know... Like Wesley Snipes, but at least Will Smith.
Yeah, there's a balance in there.
Whenever it comes to
Egyptian.
At least
get a beige brother in there.
Get a Dominican.
Steph Curry.
Get fucking Wallona's husband from Good Times. So did you fuck up at all on stage when you were doing... Were there any nights where
the play?
Yeah.
Yeah, a couple of shows.
And did one of them cover for you?
Yeah. Got great actors.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember seeing the show at the beginning of the run, Motherfucker with a Hat, and then at the end, the middle, and then the end. It was three different shows.
Yeah.
Three different shows.
Just more comfortable?
You get way more comfortable.
You get into it. You start wearing it like a second skin.
I hear it gets really boring because it's the same thing. Nah, it's like Groundhog's Day, I heard.
I was like, I would do this thing where it's like, okay, how do I ad-lib every night without changing a line?
Oh,
right. Okay.
And just like play with the performance every night.
Smart.
Right.
Yeah, because it becomes automatic after a while, and it just doesn't feel fresh coming out. Stand-up feels like that, too. If it's the same joke every night for X amount of time, there's a point where all of a sudden it no longer feels fresh and comfortable.
You know, you feel like you're Sharad.
Just say nigger next time. It hurt less.
Why can't we just do both?
Wow. Whoa.
But it becomes hard to make something feel fresh. It's like... You know, I can't. It's like sometimes Louis said something interesting about that. Sometimes you got to figure what am I trying to say, and then restructure the joke. Like the point is, I want to say, okay, this guy shouldn't have been choked by the cops, whatever, and then get to it a little bit differently. But that makes it feel fresh. And then maybe you come back to the same joke, maybe you don't. But it's all about going into a different side of the brain. Like one, it makes the whole thing a task. Yeah. He had a really interesting breakdown on why stuff feels stale after a while.
Yeah, you gotta challenge yourself too. You know. Open with your closer one night.
Yeah.
It's like dig yourself into a hole.
Yeah.
And now in the whole show, you're thinking, how am I going to close this?
And how do I follow this?
Yeah.
How do I follow this bit, which I know, you know, and sometimes I'll be doing well, and all of a sudden my closer is killing, and I'm like, why the fuck weren't you doing this the whole, like I feel like I'm running the no huddle offense at the end of the show. I'm like, why didn't you do this 10 minutes ago, shithead?
That's hilarious.
But yeah, it does. Sometimes it works really well because then you're rethinking.
You're thinking. You got to be thinking up there. You got to fucking be on your toes, man. Make it personal to that to this audience.
Right.
Yeah.
Who's the hardest comic to follow that you think you like wouldn't follow? You wouldn't want to follow.
Wouldn't want to follow? I don't go that far. But I mean, when I was coming up, Robin Williams.
Right.
But they're obvious. Rich Jenny was like a guy that would like, there's nothing left in the room. Dennis Miller would just annihilate a room. Mm. Jerry.
You said Joan Rivers in an article, too. Joan Rivers. That no one wanted to follow her.
Oh, no one wanted to follow Joan Rivers. Joan Rivers was just a beast, man.
Mm. Would say anything.
And you also don't want to follow people who are doing stuff similar to you. Like, if it's just topical stuff, even if it's not a great comedian, you don't want someone who's going to talk about exactly the same thing you're going to talk about.
Right. Yeah.
Or even have a style. You'd rather follow a prop guy or a guy that sings a lot or some shit.
Right.
Just like if you're just following a guy that's just doing jokes, or you want to. That's why guys have women open for him all the time.
I always do. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just like okay, change of pace.
It's different.
Right.
Make
it knuckleballer.
Different. Yeah.
Right. It's like you don't throw all lefties at him. You gotta mix it up. You gotta have a staff there.
You had Leslie working with you. You had Artie Fuqua. You had some people that really kill.
The shows I did at the Stress Factory. I looked at that like I was in the gym.
Right.
And I wanted the hardest punching. What's the guys you fight?
The sparring partners.
Sparring partners. So following Leslie and Artie. Woo.
Yeah.
Or Leslie and Hannibal. Woo.
Made you
work. Yeah, I don't like. I never liked following Artie when he'd get into a role because his energy was so great.
What's up with your mic today?
I don't know. It's doing a favor for the audience. just keep shutting off.
Favor for the audience. Yes. We actually got to wrap
Anthony
up anyway.
Anthony's just, you know, sending in a signal.
He's got a laser on this studio.
Yeah, he's got something like Sony.
Chris Rock, what a thrill, man.
It's good to be here, man.
This top five movie
is thanks for giving
great.
My cousin and my brother some work.
Oh, no worries, bro.
Get him off my back.
I still got to talk to you about some dude.
So, still top five. It's in theaters this Friday. I don't know. I think it's going to be great.
You're in the movie.
Yeah, it's
going
to be great.
You're in the movie. Come on. How many movies you been in?
I was in Rich Voss's movie.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
sure. So none.
No, he was the consultant for The Woodsman.
consultant for The Woodsman.
We're going to end with that. Chris Rock.
And consultant for The Woodsman.
Yeah.
And you could see...
Woodsman. Love The Woodsman.
Yeah, it was a wonderful film. Not as funny as I hope, but sexier than I thought it would be. Anthony is in it. You get to see Anthony asking his question.
Right.
And you can see me breathe like what a fish looks like when you pull it out of the tank. It's really awful.
Sherrod's got a part.
Sherrod is a part. Tom Papa.
Sam is in the background.
Yeah. Sam is fucking. Sam looks really bad. Just uncomfortable and quiet.
He's more lesbian on screen.
Yeah. We don't know what race or sex you are sitting there. Fucking despicable. But it's a really funny movie, man.
What the hell?
One of the biggest laughs I had was at your stand-up. I won't say what the line was.
Oh, my God.
You did a line. It was really, because there's a little bit of your stand-up, and it was so fucking funny.
Thanks,
I was really happy you left that in there.
Yeah.
About bad decisions people make. Just great.
Wow.
Great. The movie felt honest, man. It felt like an honest movie, like it was like you was watching somebody's real life. It's good.
Yeah, I lived it. I'm like a rapper. I lived it.
I'm like blowing him now.
Huh?
We're blowing
I told
him
you
now.
I got to talk to him about money after this.
Oh,
so I got to.
You're setting him up.
Yeah.
All right. It's a great Chris
Rock.
You
look very handsome this morning, too, Chris.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks for listening to the Opie and Jim Norton podcast. Follow the guys on Twitter at Opie Radio, at Opie Radio, and at Jim Norton. Listen to Opie and Jim Norton.